Welcome to Risk 2002. I'm here to explain the rules and regs of the tournament Risk Society. Risk, the most popular underground game in the United States today. Well, many people have played it. It goes back to 1959. Originally, the game was of a French import with French rules. Parker Brothers, over the years, decided to change the rules to the American, what's called the American rules. We believe that the French rules are better, precisely for the opposite reason that Parker Brothers. Parker Brothers introduced the American rules to speed the game up. It seemed one of the problems people had with Risk was the game lasted too long. And we hear tales of people putting it under the bed or at dormitories and colleges and when they were little kids and games going on for weeks because they didn't play the game properly. Our games last 90 minutes, sometimes less. Average games, 90 minutes. The game is played between 3 and 6 players. American rules, you can play with 2. French rules, only 3 could be the minimum. The game is for global domination of the world. It's not the world as geopolitically as we know it today. And instead are 42 provinces, 42 countries. Some of the countries are as they are today, as for instance, Great Britain and Iceland. But mostly they've been changed. 42 countries, for instance, Russia is broken down into present-day Russia, Yakutsk and Kamchatka, and Irkutsk, unfamiliar terms for most Americans. North America, even the United States, is broken down to Western and Eastern United States. Nevertheless, there are 42 countries. The game is for global domination, and we begin with our armies. Each block, wooden block in the old sets, vinyl triangles in the newer sets, and here some veteran Risk players use custom armies. Each unit represents one army. To begin the game, the American rules would have you choose your countries, etc. We deal out the cards as in the original French rules with the deck. Each card has a silhouette of and the name of a country on the card. We proceed by dealing the cards out, but before that, we must roll the dice. I'll have another comment about dice rolling in a moment. The highest player goes first. That's where he will sit. I'll mention the house rules later. And then it goes in clockwise fashion. We deal the cards out. The highest roller will be the dealer, designated dealer. The cards are dealt out, designating how many countries you have and where your armies will be. You are to put one army on every country in your card. This is your beginning. This is how the game begins. If there are 6 players, there will be 7 countries each. If there are 5 players, 2 players will get 9 and 3 will get 8. It's rounded off to the just dealt cards are just dealt out. After the armies are dealt, everybody puts down one army per card. The cards are collected and they're put back in the deck. The game can now, we also will roll to see who goes first and then proceed clockwise with the highest. If there are any ties, they will roll off. To begin the game, on your turn, you are to count up the number of countries you own. Countries, not armies. You count up the number of countries you own and divide by 3. The minimum you can get, or entitled to rather, is 3. So if you only own seven countries, you will still get 3 armies at the beginning of your turn. If you have 12 countries, as you will proceed to have later on, as you conquer more countries, you will have 4 armies at the beginning of your turn. 15, 5, 21, 7. And it's always rounded off to the lower. If you had 20 countries, you would get 6 armies at the beginning of your turn. You count your armies out of your box, put them in front of you, and then you may put them down anywhere in any country that you own. You must have 1 army in every country in the world must be occupied by an army. You proceed to put your extra armies at the beginning of your turn in the countries that you own, any which way you'd like. At the beginning of your turn, you proceed to conquer, to take over enemy countries. To attack, you must have 1 extra army in the country. If you have 1 extra army in the country, you are entitled to roll 1 die against your opponent. The country you're attacking must be adjacent, must be attached to the country that's attacking it. There are little highways or connectors attaching countries. The most significant, of course, is Kamchatka is attached to Alaska. It gets a little tricky in North America. For instance, Greenland is connected to Quebec. Greenland is here and is connected to Ontario. Ontario is connected to Northwest Territory. It's also very tricky here in Southern Europe, where Southern Europe is attached to the Middle East. Middle East is attached to East Africa. You must pay attention to all the little connected boundaries of the countries. Now, to demonstrate an attack, I'll use a yellow army. And this is the mechanics of attacking. On offense, if you have 1 extra army in the country, you may use 1 attacking die, in this case designated red. Defense, white die. You will use 1 attack, simultaneous rolling in the attack box. This is one of the house rules. We only roll in the box. Rolling simultaneously with the lead of the attacking player. Attacking player does the lead, but you're rolling simultaneously. You match the dice up. The highest die wins. In this case, the defender rolled a 2, the attacker rolled a 1, the red army loses an army. If this were reverse, and the red had rolled a 2, and the yellow a 1, the red would win. And because the red used single die, the red must move in to that territory with an army, at least 1 army. Second way, with 2 extra armies in a country, the attacking country uses 2 die, 2 dice. The defender, having 1 army, still may only use 1 die. In this case, 6 on the defense beats the highest dice on the attack. 6 beats the 6 because it is a tie. Defender wins on ties, so the red would lose a single army. As long as you have more than 1 army in a country, you can look at that army as a fort or a base or a castle, you may still proceed to attack, and the red can then attack again. If the red chooses to. Let's just say we still have our 2 armies and the red had 1. You match up the highest die from the attacker to the highest die of the defender. 6 beats the 4. Yellow moves out. Because the red used 2 dice, the red must move in at least two armies. The red can proceed to attack. You can attack as long as you have more than one army in all your countries. If we have three dice, three armies for the red, one for the yellow on defense, the red, three extra armies for the red, the red are entitled to use three dice. The defender, only one die. And on the attack, we take the highest roll for the red. And in this case, it's a four. The defender had a five. The defender wins. And the red must lose a single army because the defender only used one die. Now, in the case if the red had one, and we'll just change this to a three, the red's highest is a four. The defender, yellow, is a three. Yellow is out. The red must move in three, always leaving an army behind. Every country must be occupied. And the red may proceed to attack elsewhere. If the red had more, let's say eight armies in a country, and the defender had a single army, the red, the most dice you can use on offense is three. That is the most dice you can ever use in a risk game, is three. The attacker uses three dice because the red have more than four armies. Defender still only uses a single die, and in this roll, the highest die is a five, matched against the three. The yellow are out. They lose their army and their territory. The red must move in because the red used three dice. The red must move in at least three, but as many as you want. Now, just like we have the finger on the chess piece or the chess man in a chess game, your move into your conquered territory must take place in one move. If you have to decide your move ahead of time, contemplate it before you move your armies. We don't want to see you move three and then more. They have to be moved in one swoop. You can choose as many men, at least three, as many armies as you like. In this case, I choose to move five of my armies in, leaving three behind. I may then proceed on with the red armies to attack elsewhere, as long as I have a single army in the countries I'm occupying. Now, let's say that the yellow had two or more armies in the territory that's being attacked. In this case, it's the Ural. The yellow on defense, if you have one extra army in a country and you have two, if you have two armies or more, you may use two dice on rolling on defense. That is the most dice a defender can use, is two. A defender can never use three. And on this simple roll, you always announce the country you're attacking. We really don't favor this against this. We really would like our players to announce, as the rules say, announce the country you're attacking and the country you're attacking from. In this case, I would say it's Ukraine attacking Ural with three dice. And you roll simultaneously with the lead of the attacking player. The attacker will match up the highest die against the highest die of the defender, the next highest die with the other die of the defender. We call the roll with the highest number first. We would call a six and a four a 64. On defense, a four to one is a 41. And on the matchup, the six beats the four beats the one. The yellow loses two armies and has been removed from the territory. The red must move in three or as many as they like, with leaving one behind. In this case, I decide to move them all. I then may proceed to continue my attacks elsewhere if I choose to. Now let's imagine that the yellow had more than two. And this is how the battles ensue. I can keep attacking. In this case, it's a 66. Defense had a 1 and a 1. We match up the dice, 6 beats a 1, 6 beats a 1. Yellow would lose 2. Now, if we turn this around, and the defender rolled a 64 and the attacker a 31, we match the 3 up with the 6, the 1 up with the 4, and the 6 beats the 3, the 4 beats the 1. In this case, the red would lose 2. Now it's up to the red to decide if they want to continue the attack. If they do, the attack is done over. You keep rolling. It's up to the attacker, not the defender. In this case, it's a 43, and we announce the attacker first. 43 for the red, 52 for the defense. We match up the dice. Defender, the 5 beats the 4. The 3 beats the 2. We call this a split. Both sides lose an army, and we remove them immediately from the board. And then again, it's up to the attacker to continue the attack or desist and quit. This is how the game proceeds. You can see that if I can keep continuing, if I win my rolls, this army can move along, leaving one behind, attack again, and this is how the game progresses on one move, possibly. And you know I can attack Alaska from Kamchatka. This is the way, this is the mechanics of the game for attacking. But now let's have something about ending the turn and then other ways to get bonus armies. First place, at the end of your turn, remember, we dealt out the cards, we collected the cards, and put them in the deck. The deck goes right onto the risk logo. At the end of the turn, your turn is designated ended when you take the dice, the attacking dice, you are entitled to one free move, which is a redeployment. You can redeploy or deploy your troops, your armies, once. You can, what's called a free move, you can transfer your armies from one territory to another. As many as you like, provided you leave one army behind, and provided, of course, you own the country. So in this instance, I may redeploy my armies from Kamchatka to Yakutsk. As many as I like, and in this case I'm just going to move one up. I take my free move, and I am now entitled to a card from the deck. I take the card from the deck, and I pass the dice to the player to my left. My turn is over. Now let's have something to say for the cards. The cards probably are even more important than the luck with the dice. The cards will give you bonus armies. You don't show anyone your cards. You take a look at the card, and in this case, I have a cannon. Every card has a silhouette. A cannon, an infantryman, and a cavalryman. We sometimes call them a soldier, a horse, or a cannon. A soldier, a horse, or a cannon. At the end of every turn, you collect this card. And you're going to look at your silhouettes, the cannon, the horse, and the soldier. And combinations of these silhouettes will give you bonus armies. And this is how it works. When you have three of a kind, three cannons, three horses, or three soldiers, or if you have one of each, like this, on these cards that you've been collecting, you're entitled to bonus armies. It is called a set. Now, it just happens that you must hand in your set when you've collected five cards. You may hand in a set at the beginning of your turn, always at the beginning of your turn, if you so choose. The player that hands in the first set gets four bonus armies. The next player that hands in a set at the beginning of their turn gets six armies. The next, eight. The next, 10. The next, 12. As you can see, we increase by two every time someone hands in a set. After 12, it goes to 15. And after 15, the sets increase by five. And as you can see, it doesn't take very long, especially if you have six players, to go from 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 15. The player that hands in the sixth set will get 15 armies. So it's strategic when and how you hand in your set. Now there is one rule that we've borrowed from the American rules. Namely, if you own the country on the card that you hand in, you have to put two armies immediately on that territory. In this case, it's Western Australia. I already own it. I'm handing it in. It has to be a territory that I own. I put two armies in it immediately at the beginning of my turn. Then I count out the rest of the armies. You always try to keep your armies in your box. You count out the armies on your turn in front of you. This is very important, is getting your armies. Now, strategy-wise, there's a third way to get extra armies, bonus armies. By controlling a continent. I mentioned there are six continents. By owning every territory in a continent, you get bonus armies. And in this, the original board, it's along, color-coded along the side to remind you. But it's simple enough. The smallest continents, Australia and South America, because there are only four territories in the continent, will get, if you control every territory in that continent at the beginning of your turn, you will get two bonus armies every turn, if you could control it at the beginning of your turn. It makes those two continents very important. If you control all six territories in the continent of Africa, you will get three bonus armies at the beginning of your turn. If you control every country, every one of the six territories in Africa. If you control every territory in Europe, all seven territories at the beginning of your turn, you then will be entitled to five bonus armies at the beginning of your turn. If you have an army in every one of the European territories, all seven of them, at the beginning of your turn, you will get five extra armies, along with the number of armies you get for the countries that you own. If you take over and control all nine territories in North America, you will get five bonus armies at the beginning of your turn. If you control every territory in North America continent, you will get five bonus armies. There are 12 territories in Asia. If you're able, it's not likely in most games, if you could control every one of the 12 territories in Asia, you will get seven bonus armies at the beginning of your turn. So, there are three ways to get armies at the beginning of your turn. First, count up your countries. Divide by three. 12 countries, four armies. You count them out of your box. Second way to get bonus armies is to hand in a set at the beginning of your turn. The first set is worth four. It increases by two to 12. It goes to 3 to 15, and then proceeds, it increases by 5 every time someone ends in a set. Those are the three ways, and of course, as I mentioned, controlling a continent. You may control two continents. If you control the whole Western Hemisphere, North and South America, you would get 7 bonus armies at the beginning of your turn. So, the number of territories you control, the sets you hand in, and controlling continents determines how many armies you begin your turn with. Now, how do you win the game? And this is where or how some games go on in length and take a long time. Winning the game, it's not as easy as some other games, because this is a game where you must take over the whole world. And to win this game, you must wipe out your opponents. Wipe them out. By wiping them out, that means to take every one of the territories they control on your turn. If you do so, you inherit. You get their cards, the cards that they have been in their pile. You must hand in the set if you have 5 cards. You may choose to if you have a set and it's less than 5. And then you can continue your turn. And you can see, this is a domino effect. If you wipe somebody out for their cards, you hand in a set, you may wipe out another player for their cards, and then another player for their cards. Or if that may not be the case, you will be stronger, usually, by wiping somebody out and getting their cards. And this is how a game ends. I have to mention, in the set, in the deck of cards, there are 2 wild cards. They're called jokers, or wild cards. When the cards are collected back after the original deal, these 2 jokers, wild cards, are put back in the deck, shuffled, cards are cut. These wild cards represent all 3 of the silhouettes. A wild card and any other 2 cards makes an immediate set. Well, I think it's time for some tips on strategy and, of course, the house rules. I just want to review them again. All roles are simultaneous. That's in the rules, the written rules by Parker Brothers. But all roles are thrown in the box. Now, if a player throws a die out of the box, he doesn't pick up all his dice and re-roll. He's only allowed to roll the die that rolls out of the box over. Sometimes we shall see, it happens frequently sometimes, that dice collide in the box. Tough luck. We are gentlemen, we don't aim for each other's dice, but that sometimes happens. Sometimes the defending player will roll the dice ahead of the attacking player. The attacking player doesn't have to roll. Nevertheless, we try to maintain a gentleman's position in this game. And by that I mean we don't play alliances, whether they're overt or covert. That's very ungentlemanly. There are no alliances. Alliances also would make the game longer. There is only one winner in a risk game. Everyone else is a loser. It doesn't matter if you came in 6th or you came in 2nd. A player that plays 2nd, comes in 2nd, is as much a loser as the player that comes in 6th. We play for a prize precisely for that point. We'll announce the prize at another given time. We also don't play with vengeance or vindictiveness. As gentlemen, we have no name calling. We hold our tempers in check. This could be a very volatile game. We don't want to be too opinionated. Table talk is outlawed. By table talk, we mean either propaganda, revealing numbers, revealing cards, giving any points of strategy to the opponent players. Case in point is that games are won and lost on mistakes. Our best players make mistakes, and we allow the person that's playing the game to lose on their own mistakes. That's the best lesson, is to learn from your mistakes, and that's exactly precisely what we do. We learn from our mistakes. Games are players make mistakes all the time. Why is the game called Risk? Risk is called Risk because that's exactly what you have to do in this game. You must decide whether a move is a risk move or not. And we're talking about wiping somebody out. It's a risk. Dice is the luck factor. There's luck factor with dice. There's luck factor with the cards. The dice are evident in the sense that if you just keep on rolling ones and twos, you're in trouble. With the cards, you may have four cards, and you may have what we call TP, and that would be two horses and two cannons, or two soldiers and two cannons, or combinations of two. That does not give you a set, and you're at a disadvantage. Now for a word on some strategy. At the beginning of your move, where it said be advised, you're best putting your armies in one country to get more firepower. By putting down three armies in a country, I am entitled to use three dice. And you never, you're ill-advised to break your armies down and put them one and one and one piecemeal. You can only use a single die in that fashion. Think in terms of building up, especially in the beginning of the game, a power base. A power base. Think more on the offense than defense. If you try to stop someone from getting a continent or try to stop someone from winning, it really doesn't help you win the game. What you really are doing is helping a third party win the game. Now, the beginning of the game, continents are important, but the continents that are the most important are the smallest for two reasons. First place, they're easy to take, only consisting of four territories, and they're also easy to defend. Australia only has one roadway in to Indonesia. South America has only two ways in under to defend. So you want to defend your continent because your opponents are going to make it an issue with you collecting and getting bonus armies every turn. The other continent that is prized is Africa. In Africa, you get three bonus armies every turn. Africa has the advantage to being in the center of the world. One of the, Australia's disadvantage, it's in a corner of the world, far removed from North America. It's boxed in. South America has two avenues of attack and two avenues to defend. But Africa is centrally located. It can touch Asia, Europe, and South America. It's very prized. We call this Australia, South America, and Africa, the Southern Hemisphere. Very strategic. Now, new players sometimes envy or have ambitions for the Northern Hemisphere. North America, the advantage, of course, being only three avenues to attack from and defend. consisting of 9 territories, or Europe, only 7, and you get 5 bonus armies every turn. Well, the reality is that not only is Europe hard to defend, Europe can be attacked from 6 other territories, but you become a red flag to your opponents in the rest of the world. They wouldn't allow, enjoy seeing you control in Europe or North America. As for Asia, it's rare that anyone ever controls Asia. The advantage given to the person controlling Asia would be stupendous. They would have 7 bonus armies every turn, especially in the beginning of the game. So a strategy would be to forego with your ambitions in the Northern Hemisphere, think of the Southern Hemisphere. Now, another word on that. You may find yourself going for a continent in the Southern Hemisphere, Australia or South America. You may be enjoined by another player. And what happens then is both players, and it happens frequently, will have a war, what we call a war of attrition, where both powers, both players will stockpile armies and wage a 100 years war with each other, battling it out to the demise of both of them. They will both go down in flames, allowing the other players in the game gain an advantage. It does happen. So if you don't readily win your continent, you best think of going elsewhere, because otherwise you'll both die if you fight for too long for that continent. Now, if you can't go to the Southern Hemisphere, how can you still win the game? Well, we consider, and many games, half the games are won from the Northern Hemisphere. We call this the nomadic strategy, or being in the hills. We always call this the hills in the Northern Hemisphere. What you want to do strategically is try to stay alive until the sets come in. To do that, you want to put armies in two to three hemispheres. If we consider Australia, Asia, one hemisphere, and Europe, another hemisphere, and North America, the third. You would want to keep armies in clusters, like this, say, in two different hemispheres. And in this fashion, you are on the lookout for your weaker opponent in the hills, and you're surviving until the sets come in. And sets. Now, you strategy-wise, as I said before, if you concentrate on trying to stop some from winning, you're not going to win. But on the other hand, we really don't want to see anyone getting away with a continent with, say, a one-army defense or a two-army defense. It's not so much to not break that continent up. We also have to be careful of two things in risk: the weakest player and the strongest player. Now, the weakest player, must be careful for the weakest player, because the reality is, if the weakest player is wiped out, they lose their cards. The player that wipes them out can proceed to snowball, and as I said, the domino effect, and you too will be wiped out before you even go again. So you look at the weaker player for two reasons. One, you may wipe them out, but secondly, you have to try to prevent the stronger player from wiping them out. And so we'll see players protecting, protection. For instance, a strategic place to protect would be Japan is a strategic. And in this fashion, Japan is protected by the yellow. You may see a protection other places. And so you want to be on the lookout for the weaker opponent and the stronger. By the strongest opponent does not mean the player with the most countries or even the most continents or the strongest amount of armies on the board. But by midway into the game, the strongest opponent, the strongest player, is the player with the most cards. with the five cards. Let's underscore that. Five cards guarantees a set. And that is the most dangerous player. Now, we roll for seats, and this is a house rule. We have two rolls. The first roll is where we sit, and that's important. This is a house rule, so you don't get beat up by the same opponent every game. We roll for where we sit, and then and how the cards are dealt out clockwise. And then we roll to see who goes first. And it's important where you sit, because you can hurt the player on your left, your immediate left, that goes next, because they can recover. They go next, especially if they have a five-card set. Now, if you attack the opponent on your right, the player to your right, it will take him, in a six-man game, he has to survive through four other players. And if they beat up on him, he may be in heaven before you go again. So you have to be careful of who you're attacking by the seating arrangement. Another point of strategy is not different players play different ways. And namely, you want to keep your armies in forward positions. For instance, if I were in South America, there is no reason to leave two armies behind. You want to put your troops, your armies, in front positions. So on your free move, you free move them up. Take your card, pass the dice. There have been players, the best golden rule for players as far as strategy, because when you're playing with six players, everyone wants to do the attacking and do something on your turn. You've waited for five other players' turns. You want to do something on your turn right away. So you want to make an attacks, and that will only hurt you in the end. You want to basically take one territory, stop, take your card, be conservative, build up your strength slowly, whether you're playing in the Northern Hemisphere or you're going for your continent. Be conservative. If you throw your armies away on attacks, you'll be as thin as soup and be in jeopardy of being wiped out. Well, I think that's most of what I have to say. You try not to be satisfied with what you have. There are players that say, well, I'm going to be a happy continent man and just build up in Australia and live happily ever after. You will not win the game that way. This is a game of offense, attacking, and global domination. So with that, I salute you, and may the best army win. And then, there'll be players that'll be happy to have their little happy, we call them the happy continent men. And they just are happy to have their little Australia, their little South America, they build up. They don't want to do anything. They're doing this because they're pacifists or something, or defensive. They're happy with their turf. This is a game of offense. You only win by attacking. You only win by wiping someone out. You're doing them a favor. You're putting them in heaven. This is what they need and want. There's only one winner. So it's a little bit more than competition. It's a little bit more dynamic than a polka game. You know, in polka, you only have the cards close to your chest. Here we have dice, cards, and strategy, thinking. And they're all important. So the dynamic of three. Another strategy that I didn't get to say before, this is an addendum to my previous statements, is when you, a strategy for the continents, of course, and for the hill players, people up in the Northern Hemisphere, players in the North, is to cut colonies. You want to remove all the Australian territories from North America. Likewise, you want to remove all the South American colonies' territories from Asia and Europe. And of course, you want to remove all the African territories from North America. Box those continents in. That's the best strategy for the Northern Hemisphere hill players against the continental players. More than that, South America and Australia, which are usually the first two continents taken in a game, this is how they can fight each other. On the same, conversely, they're going to try to stay alive in the other hemisphere. Australia will try to camp out in North America. South America will try to camp out in Asia. But it's to all the other players' advantages to eliminate that possibility. Cut those colonies. A well-pointed strategy. You don't know what you're doing, that's what you do. Oh, by the way, what you are doing is so important. Because we want to expedite the game as quickly as possible, while all the other players are going, and in a six-man game that means there are five other players, this gives you the opportunity to think of what you're going to do on your move. You are to plan, plot, make up strategies. The board doesn't change all that much, especially when you're only taking one country and stopping. You are to get your thinking cap on and think of your move, so when the dice are passed to you, you put your armies down and you proceed. You know exactly what you're going to do. You may have to ramify it a little bit, have some contingency plans, but we want you to move on your turn. The only time we give extra time to a player is when they hand in a set. Otherwise, you're supposed to be moving. If you hand in a set, we'll cut you some slack because we know you're thinking of possible risk move. Now, as far as talking, all propaganda, all table talk is banned. We don't want anybody giving out numbers, how many armies other opponents have. You, on your turn, you may ask all your opponents how many cards they have. And you always proceed in clockwise fashion to your left. And you have to ask all the players. If you single just one player out, you're putting the spotlight on them. And that's a no-no. We never want to spotlight one player against another. So you ask all the players in turn for their card count on your turn. And be fair, try to do it only once so that we don't have any stall techniques. One other item is the armies will build up. And we have 10 spots. They're called oblong submarines. We have many different choice names. And these little figures represent 10 armies. And we always want to make them clearly sighted. That's 10 armies. You may put them down at any given time. There are different fashions of them. This is the original wooden set, so this designates 10 red armies. In the custom set, this is a single army, and this is 10 armies. And you always put them a little bit to the side so your opponents may be able to count up your troops, your armies. There's another little house rule that I want to add in. We don't want to scare anyone and surprise you. If in the deal, the shuffle, and this does happen even in six-man games, if you're dealt every territory in the continent, it's a redeal. We don't want to start off with such a disadvantage to any one player. And that's agreed upon. If anyone is dealt every territory in the continent, we redeal. We don't re-roll, we redeal. And that's it. We salute you.